come into this gathering place. Come in and find peace and rest. Inspiration and aspiration. Fellowship and love. Come in and find light for your darkness. A friend's smile for your loneliness. And music for your soul. Come in and let our hearts sing for all the blessings that are ours this day. Let us pray. O Shining One, you are the flame burning within, the beacon on the horizon, the radiance in all creation, the bright idea apprehending us, the sparkling in the eyes of our loved ones, the uncreated light that is lighting all. Transfigure us this very day as we open into the radiance of the Christ in each other, in song, in word, and witness. May this be the day of our enlightenment, when we see with clarity the sacred light we are called to manifest, sharing love with all. Remake us as sacraments of the holy, that we might embrace our calling, to see with new eyes, reach out with gentle hands, imagine with transformed minds, be still with hallowed presence, and be filled with grateful prayers. In the name of Jesus, the Transfigured One, we pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Peace be with you. Let's offer each other a sign of peace.
Good morning, and welcome to Fort Massey on this, the 14th of February? It's hard to believe. It's our 44th Sunday service online. And for those of you who are joining us for the very first time via the camera today, our cameraman is Ian McDonald. Joining me is Jenny Trites here at the piano and the organ. And Jade, here she is, Jade back there, our song leader, and Verain, of course, our liturgist. Today is also Transfiguration Sunday. You might have sort of clued into that if you were following along those wonderful words of that very first hymn, which pretty much tells the story of Transfiguration. It's a day when the church commemorates the Transfiguration of Christ on a mountaintop in the presence of three disciples, and that is observed on the Sunday before Lent in most Protestant churches. In the Catholic Church, I believe it's probably sometime in August, perhaps. In the Christian teachings, the Transfiguration is a pivotal moment, and the setting on the mountain is presented as the point where human nature meets God, with Jesus himself as the connecting point, acting as the bridge between heaven and earth. And I suppose you might even call it a love story. And what better day to tell it than on St. Valentine's Day. Happy Valentine's Day. And one way we can show our love on Valentine's Day, of course, is to wear our masks. Of course, not just on Valentine's Day, we wear those masks every day. And I think the children have some Valentines that arrived in the mailbox. I see that Lily took that down with her, so she'll share that with the children later on this morning. Of course, I continue to get some interesting PowerPoint slides, and there's the first one, speaking of masks. That one there says, if you have to wear both masks and glasses, you may be entitled to condensation. Those of us who wear glasses know exactly what they're talking about. And this other one here, women's eyes are more noticeable because it's the mask era. Ha, ha, ha. So, thank you, Ruth, for sending those in to me this week. It's also Nova Scotia Heritage Day tomorrow. And we're commemorating our 2021 honoree, Edward Francis Arad. And I did some research on him. Lieutenant Edward Francis Arad. He was born right here in Halifax in 1915. He was the eldest of five children. And his father immigrated as a child with his family from Demon, Lebanon, during the Ottoman rule, looking for a better life. And it is because of this that many families from the village of Demon chose to settle right here in Nova Scotia, and their descendants continue to live here and thrive here today. But Edward himself, he attended St. Patrick's Boys School. Of course, that was the building is no longer there, but it was up there here on Quimple Road. And at the age of 16, joined the Canadian Officers Training Corps, which was based at that time at Dalhousie University. And after his BA, he graduated with honors with a law degree from the Dal Law School. And he opened his own practice and quickly gained a reputation for accepting cases that addressed issues of prejudice and racism. He was proud of his Lebanese heritage. He spoke Arabic. And he helped in 1938 to found the Canadian Lebanon Society, serving as their first president. And in 1942, he volunteered for active service during World War II, and in 1944, he died along with 13,000 Allied soldiers, half of whom were Canadians, capturing a vital shipping route. And his life and contributions were celebrated in 1949 through the naming of a street in his honor right here in Halifax. The Edward Arap Avenue is in the Westmount area of our city. So we remember him and give thanks for his living and for his contribution to our province and to our country. Our church notices are found in your bulletin, which of course you can find online, or you, those of you who are lucky enough to get one and came here early enough to pick one up, you have one with you. And somebody pointed out to me that it says in the bulletin that there's an insert for the communion. That was last year's mistake, so there is no insert for your communion this week. Lorraine and I will do all the liturgy for communion this Sunday. This is happy birthday time for those of you who have birthdays in February. And my bulletin tells me that Kathy Evans, you had a birthday on the 12th, is that correct? Yes, and then we have Roy George, who has one on the 17th, and Joyce McDowell on the 23rd. Did you have one? Who? Oh, Clarissa on the 4th. Happy birthday. So, oh, by all means, certainly. If you've already had it or it's coming up, we want to wish you a happy birthday. We do have a few folk that have been under the weather, and namely Peter Conich, and I believe Alan Gillis up in Cape Breton. Is he doing a little bit better? Yeah. And Allison McDonald. So keep them all in your thoughts and prayers at this time, as they hopefully are all on the road to recovery. Just an honorable mention to our janitor, sexton, Kevin Robarts, does a great job keeping this building. He's here every day, practically, mopping up and what have you. And it makes his job a little bit easier when you come into the doors, especially during the week. And I'm awful burnt that many of you coming in during the week, but for those of you who do, and it's a snowy day, a reminder to you to keep those boots clean so that we don't see any puddles on our floors, which can become a hazard for those who happen to walk on water. Walking on water is not as easy as you might think, although the Bible will tell you differently. Also, I need to explain to you how to open your communion little cup. Did everybody get a little communion cup when they came in? You should have. If you didn't, raise your hand, and I'll make sure that somebody sends one your way. Anyway, there are two little openings on it. The very first one you'll notice is purple, so don't rip them both off. So you want to take the purple one off first, the purple piece of plastic. There it is there. And underneath that, you will find your bread wafer. There it is there. Have you ever been to Catholic Mass and had a wafer? That's exactly what they look like. So you just, when the time comes, you put it in your mouth. It's kind of crunchy at first. And then you'll see a little silver lining on top for your juice. So you just peel that back and have a drink. When you're done with it, you can just take it and with you and put it in the garbage disposal in the Tobin Street lobby or the Queen Street lobby, depending which way you come in. Now, so that's instructions on communion for you. And everyone is invited to partake in communion. If the children want to come back up through communion, they're more than welcome to as well. A reminder to you, your offering envelopes, if you have already picked them up in the Queen Street lobby. We're still looking for tellers for people to count the Sunday morning offering. There are sign-up sheets in at the back there, and in the Tobin Street lobby. So we appreciate if you'd like to take a Sunday to do that. Be very helpful to the Finance Committee. Coming up this week, the coffee party at 10:30, via Zoom on Wednesday. Our book study starts at 10:30. If you haven't picked up your book, they're out there in the lobby, your name on it. And our choir practice at 7:15 here in the sanctuary. And our men's Kirk suit competition for the Vickers Label Trophy, two Sundays from now. So men, please get your recipes ready. And we're asking the men, when you're making the soup, to, if you wouldn't mind, emailing the recipe into us so we can share the recipe with others. And please, when you're doing that, do not leave out the most important ingredient. Sometimes people will do that so that your version of it won't taste as good as theirs. So you don't want to be one of those. So be sure and get your soup going as to what you're going to be making. And of course, we're going to give the soup away after, and if you want to make a little donation to the UCW, that would be great as well. Not necessary, but you're more than welcome to. We appreciate it. And of course, annual meeting March the 14th, right here in the sanctuary at 11:30.
As we bring our gifts forward, may our whole life move forward in good faith, with good feelings, and with a good belief about the future. May what we give today and all that we receive for the enrichment of our life and the lives of others. May all that we receive be for the enrichment of our life and the lives of others. Our offerings for celebration of life in this place and beyond shall now be received.
Was an endangered institution. He officiated for couples seeing them split, then officiated when they married someone else. I think people expect too much from marriage today, he said. They expect perfection. Every moment should be bliss. That's TV or movies, but that is not the human experience. The trick is, when things aren't so great, you don't jump the whole thing. It's okay to have an argument. It's okay that the other one nudges you a little, bothers you a little. It's part of being close to someone. But the joy you get from that same closeness when you watch your children or when you wake up and smile at each other, that, as our tradition teaches us, is a blessing. People forget this. Why do they forget it? Because the word commitment has lost its meaning. I'm old enough to remember when it used to be a positive. A committed person was someone to be admired. He or she was loyal and steady. Now a commitment is something you avoid. You don't want to tie yourself down. It's the same with faith, by the way. We don't want to get stuck having to go to services all the time or having to follow the rules. We don't want to commit to God. We'll take God when we need God or when things are going good. But real commitment, that requires staying power in faith and in marriage. And if you don't commit, your choice, the rabbi responds, but you miss what's on the other side. What's on the other side? Ah, he smiled. A happiness you cannot find alone. Here ends the first reading.
Our second reading comes from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 1 to 7. I may speak in tongues of men or of angels, but if I have no love, I am a sounding gong or a clanging cymbal. I may have the gift of prophecy and the knowledge of every hidden truth. I may have faith enough to move mountains, but if I have no love, I am nothing. I may give all I possess to the needy. I may give my body to be burnt, but if I have no love, I gain nothing by it. Love is patient and kind. Love envies no one, is never boastful, never conceited, never rude. Love is never selfish, never quick to take offense. Love keeps no score of wrongings, takes no pleasure in the sins of others, but delights in the truth. There is nothing love cannot face. There is no limit to its faith, its hope, its endurance. Offer this wisdom for the journey.
May we walk in its light.
Thank you.
Well, the book, Have a Little Faith, from which our first reading came this morning, is the story, as you might have gathered, of a rabbi, Reb, as his congregation called him. And his wife, Sarah, would often say, "I've had 30 wonderful years with my husband, and I'll never forget the day we were married, November the 3rd, 1944. Wait, someone would say, doing the math, that's way more than 30 years. It was over 60 years at the time. Right, she would say. On Monday, you'd get 20 great minutes. On Tuesday, you'd get a great hour. You put it all together, you get 30 great years. And everyone would laugh, and her husband would beam. In a list of suggestions for young clerics, he had once written, "Find a good partner." He had found his. Well, the rabbi had officiated at nearly 1,000 weddings and was often asked whether he could predict which ones would last. Sometimes, he said, if they're communicating well, they have a good chance. And if they have a similar belief system, similar values, they have a good chance. What about love? The person would ask. Love, they should always have. But love changes. Well, what do you mean? Love, the infatuation kind, he's so handsome, she's so beautiful. That can shrivel. As soon as something goes wrong, that kind of love can fly out the window. And on the other hand, a true love can enrich itself. It gets tested and grows stronger. When Teddy in Fiddler on the Roof says, "How can you ask if I love you? Look at what I've done with you. What else would you call it?" That kind of love, the kind you realize you already have by the life you've created together, that's the kind that lasts. Today is Valentine's Day, a day, of course, for romance and relationships, for celebrating love in our lives, whether in marriage or in friendship, in partnership or community. A tough day in a time of physical distancing when we wish we could, of course, hug more people and hold hands and show our love. Today, some are remembering past loves. Some are remembering better days when a relationship worked and wondering if they will ever find that again. And some are dreaming about it and assuming that the white knight on the charger will arrive someday. But love is not a day. It is a lifetime. And a relationship is more than flowers and chocolates and words on a card. 20 good minutes here and there, looking back over all that you have created together, a life with good and tough moments. That is what long marriages are about, and there are fewer and fewer of those around, perhaps you've noticed. And yet all of us are looking for love, whether in community, or maybe in friendship, or romance, in a long-term relationship. I enjoy a show where people go house hunting in the United Kingdom. It's called Escape to the Country. And lately I've been noticing that very few, if any, of the couples have long marriages. Most of them are on their second or, or their third spouse, and they talk about children and grandchildren, but they are his or hers, not ours. Long relationships, it seems, are becoming unusual. And maybe CTDs live at 5 with their best wishes to couples married 50 and 60 years may slowly disappear. Well, the writer of the letter to the church at Corinth that Verain just read to you is well known. For the words in the 13th chapter, there's nothing love cannot face. There's no limit to its faith and its hope and its endurance. And yet we recognize the wisdom of the rabbi's comment that the infatuation, that love which sweeps people off their feet will shrivel. In good times and bad, for too many people now means only in good when times get tough. Commitment is no longer a value, is one of the rabbi's comments, and we nod our heads. How many times do people say to us, well, you know, I don't like to commit myself, whether it is to do something minor or major. Keeping your options open, taking risks, those are the new values which seemingly have replaced those of a previous generation. And churches are all well aware that this is a value disappearing. We're watching massive shifts in society, and we are trying desperately to adjust. And yet we also know that the days when couples stayed together forever because getting a divorce was impossible or almost were not ideal either. And we know that too many people stayed in abusive and difficult relationships. Too many women had no power and too many men had too much. And so we adjust, and sometimes we have to think, and we have to think, and we have to think again. Well, most of us are uncomfortable with societies where marriages are arranged. If you have watched, or if you've been watching The Crown on Netflix, like my mother has been doing, she binge-watched all the seasons, likely you shake your heads at the marriages of our royals, for whether we call them arranged officially, they were. A 40-year-old woman wrote a controversial essay a number of years ago now, telling women if they wanted marriage and family, they should settle. Don't look for passion or intense connection. Don't look for the perfect soulmate. She's written a book called Marry Him, The Case for Settling for Mr. Goodenough. And she insists that women in their 20s have the most choice and that they are too picky. Whereas people used to stay relatively close to home and married someone likely to have similar values, the choices are now, she says, so many, that too many go in search of the Holy Grail and want excitement. And she writes, how much fun is it to be in a marriage where one person ends up cheating, and there's all kinds of drama, and nobody can hold down a job, and no one's taking care of the kids. It might be more fun to be with someone who you love, and whose company you enjoy, and who you can depend on. And it's not more exciting, but it works. The fairy tales with the happily ever after are just that. Of course, they are fairy tales. and we all watched the Princess Diana drama as it went from wedding vows to a deeply unhappy couple standing apart with body language that said it all, "I want to be anywhere except here." And you and I, well, we live in the world of human experience. You know, where the plot changes, where we may discover that things, well, they don't happen the way we planned them, and where things change, and then they change again. Well, the community of faith, that's you and I, also requires a level of commitment, and it too is changing as commitment disappears. And it may take us some time to figure out how to operate in this new world where we find ourselves. But we use the old formulas and then we wonder why they don't work. We do things the same way over and over and hope that this time it's going to take. We may have to figure out how to be the community of faith in a new world, how to create those connections for people who are looking for friendship and human contact. And in the year 2021, we know how difficult it is even to begin to offer it. You watch church online a few times and you know pretty quickly why it does not feel quite like church, because the humanity of it is missing, is it not? Worship's not meant to be a spectator sport. We don't come out to sit and cheer. We come out to be with one another, with each other. And at communion, we look to our left and we look to our right and know that it is about each other. We lose something when it comes in a pre-wrapped package, and we cannot look at each other, for masks make that pretty difficult. It is a day for love, which comes in all sizes and shapes, the love of parents for children, the love of friends for each other, the love of partners, married or not, and the love of faith. The love which we experience as the ground of our being, which we call God, or the Spirit, or the force which changes our living. May we study love and learn to love and work on relationships and community and being the people of God in a world which is in need of loving people in the year of COVID more than ever. Amen. And amen. Let's stand and sing our communion hymn. Before that, Brain's going to lead us in the affirmation. You're still going to have to stand.
Let us affirm our faith. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God. Who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We're called to be the Church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect and creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our Judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
Life is a gift, and we its celebration. May we rejoice in the beauty that we are. We give thanks and praise for all that is good in the world, for the mystery we name God, for the sage we name Jesus, for the renewing strength and freedom of the Spirit. O God of winter, the unpopular, slandered season, God of hail and sleet, wind and storm, God of brisk winter mornings, the snow-covered yards and the slippery sidewalks, of warm socks, coats and gloves, scarves, hats, and warm fires, we open ourselves to all the possibilities life offers us. So we join in our celebration to all people, saying, Holy, holy, holy,
recreating God,
heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of God.
Hosanna in the highest. We remember the time when Jesus faced difficult decisions and destructive forces. In the days and nights of his searching, in finding ways to free others from images and ideas that kept them captive and dependent and fearful of God, in breaking down social and religious barriers, in facing failure, in facing death. When we too experience the winter of our lives, may we find the courage to let go and trust in your guiding, warming light. And as we eat together at this table, we remember the importance and the words and the actions of all meals in the tradition of Jesus. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his friends. He poured a cup of wine, offered thanks for it, and gave it also to his friends.
Everyone is welcome to be here.
In this way, we lift up a world of inclusion where all people live with respect and dignity.
Everyone present will receive a share.
In this way, we lift up a world of generosity where, as in the examples of Jesus, abundance overcomes scarcity, so all are fed.
Everyone is invited now to take a portion and to see that others also receive.
In this way, we lift up a world of sufficiency, where entrenched systems of privilege are challenged, wealth is shared equally, and all are satisfied with enough.
And so in the meal tradition of Jesus, we break bread and share bread and drink from the cup, pledging ourselves to allow the Spirit that moved in Jesus to move freely in your life, in my life, in our lives. I invite you now to partake of the bread and then the cup.
Eat it.
God of amazing grace, in the cold of the winter months, we are grateful for your presence warming us. We pray this presence will strengthen us to follow in the way of Jesus, this day and every day, in this city and in this country. Amen.
Sacred space. Pack away a piece of this church in your heart. Wrap it carefully like a precious gem. Carry it with you through the joys and sorrows of your days. Let its gentle glow, strengthen you, warm you, remind you of all that is good and true. Until you gather here again in this place of love, amen. And may it be so.